You're sound asleep in the middle of the night when suddenly your bedroom starts shaking. Mirrors and furniture come crashing down. Gas and water lines break open and fire rages. Well, that's what people in Northern California lived through this weekend when an earthquake hit at 3 in the morning yesterday.
It was the strongest quake in 25 years, but the big one is still in the future and it could be far worse. Caitlin Burke has the story.
The powerful earthquake hit early Sunday morning, jolting thousands of people from their beds.
There were some explosions, and it was burning, and everybody was out in the street.
More than 150 people were injured, and hundreds of homes destroyed. The tremors were so strong they'd burst gas lines in this mobile home community.
We did have a major water main break just outside the mobile home park, and which really complicated the firefight.
In the historic downtown area, bricks crumbled from buildings, windows shattered, and streets buckled. At one point, at least 64,000 residents were without power. Operation Blessing is on the ground in Napa today, ready to help with cleanup efforts.
Operation Blessing is going to be working with local churches and local emergency management to help the residents of California get back on their feet.
As cleanup begins on this most recent quake, scientists warn that California is in the danger zone for one much larger. In fact, they estimate that there's a 99% chance of a quake 6.7 magnitude or larger within the next 30 years. A 2008 study by the U.S. Geological Survey said a 7-point magnitude quake would kill 2,000 people and cause $200 billion worth of damage. And it said, quote, "The question is not if, but when Southern California will be hit by a major earthquake, one so damaging that it will permanently change lives and livelihoods in the region." Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
Well, Caitlin, we aren't exactly looking forward to that, but we know it's coming, so we hope that their friends in California will prepare for it. Well, the quake that was there in the Napa Valley and beyond, Operation Blessing is already on the scene. Some of the things that they're doing right now, they are working with local churches and local emergency management to help the victims of that quake. If you want to help Operation Blessing, you can call 1-800-759-0700 or Operation Blessing Disaster Relief. Let's help those who are suffering. Well, in other news, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is warning the people of Israel that the war with Hamas could last through September. John Jessup has that story from our CBN News Bureau in Washington. Here's John.
Pat, Prime Minister Netanyahu is promising Israel won't stop military operations against Hamas until it's accomplished all its goals. That statement came after one of Hamas's deadly attacks killed a 4-year-old Israeli boy. Chris Mitchell brings us the story from just outside Jerusalem.
Israel bombed a Hamas command and control center in Gaza over the weekend. It's part of the latest round of fighting after Hamas broke a ceasefire for the 11th time in the month-and-a-half-old conflict.
This Iron Dome anti-missile battery shot down a rocket headed towards Jerusalem over the weekend. Hamas has launched more than 700 rockets and mortars at Israel since breaking the ceasefire.
On Friday, 4-year-old Daniel Tragerman died in a mortar attack on Kibbutz Nahal Oz near the Gaza border. In another attack, a rocket struck a synagogue in Ashdod. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu said Hamas would continue to pay a heavy price for what he called the crimes that it's perpetrating. Hamas publicly executed 18 Palestinians it accused of collaborating with Israel. Human rights groups across the political spectrum condemn the executions. Meanwhile, Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas said he plans to unveil what he called an unconventional solution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Abbas linked his future with Hamas, despite Israel's revelation last week that the terror group planned to overthrow him.
This delegation includes all Palestinian factions, including Hamas, in order to return to the negotiation table to achieve a long-term ceasefire and to discuss other issues on the negotiation table afterwards.
But negotiations with Hamas remains a non-starter for Israel, since the group's main goals are killing Jews and destroying the Jewish state. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, in the hills of Jerusalem.
Pat, the situation there just seems to be getting worse.
Well, it really does. You know, the Wall Street Journal had a rather insightful editorial having to do with this killing of these so-called sympathizers. And what they said, basically, the world is saying to Israel, why don't you make common cause with the moderate Palestinians so that you can gain peace? And what this editorial said, and it's true, is that the Hamas and the radicals will kill any moderate who makes any effort whatsoever to make peace with Israel. So they gunned down 18 innocent people. They don't know what they were. They just randomly picked them out. They may have been friendly to Israel, or they may have been just saying, let's have peace with Israel. That's all it took to get killed. So how can they ever be peace in that area as long as these crazy radical people are in charge? And Hamas rules Gaza, and they've got to be rooted out. And it's going to take force, and it's going to be messy. You can't go into an urban area without some collateral damage. And there will be collateral damage, but it has to be, because Hamas is firing rockets at Israel. They are provoking a confrontation. They want a fight. They want to stay out in front of the donor nations in the Arab world. And it's high time those donor nations say Hamas should be thrown under the bus and get on. But Abbas is too weak to be a leader. He can't lead, and the Palestinian Authority has been notoriously corrupt. So in any event, Forbes magazine has a story about this whole thing, and here's John to tell us about it.
That's right, Pat. Forbes magazine says they're investigating how the international press is mishandling the coverage of the war between Israel and Hamas. Investigative journalist Richard Bahar focuses much of his attention on the New York Times. He says so much of the Western coverage has been predictably skewed against Israel through those time-honored journalism tools of sloppy and lazy reporting, superficiality, nuance, omission, lack of historical knowledge, or flat-out agenda-driven lies and bias. The Foreign Press Association in Israel says Hamas has been intimidating foreign reporters and condemned the terrorists for their actions. Investigative reporter Gary Weiss says news outlets have, quote, become part of the Hamas war machine. The U.S. government says an American held hostage for about 2 years in Syria has been released. National Security Advisor Susan Rice confirms Peter Theo Curtis of Massachusetts is now safe. According to Secretary of State John Kerry, he was held captive by an al-Qaeda-linked militant group fighting the Syrian government. The United Nations says it helped with Curtis being turned over to UN peacekeepers in Israel. Meanwhile, hundreds of people attended a massive remembrance for James Foley, the American journalist who was shown in a video being murdered by ISIS. A Roman Catholic bishop says Foley lived his faith by showing the world images of people affected by war. Well, terrorists from the Islamic State have threatened to kill another American reporter, as the group has also been attacking Christians and Yazidis in northern Iraq, creating a refugee crisis. But as Gary Lane reports, CBN Disaster Relief is working to help these victims.
Tens of thousands of Iraqi Christians now live in tents, schools, and abandoned buildings. War-weary and despondent, most now say they want to leave Iraq.
Go to America. Christian, go to America. Christian, no live in Iraq.
When Islamic State fighters seized his city, this former police officer took his family, including his newborn daughter, to safety in Erbil. If we return to our village, they will kill us, he says. With passports in hand, these Iraqi Christians hope Congress will soon grant them immediate religious asylum status so they can live in the United States. 10 families from this church, Ankawa Evangelical, have already left Iraq since the crisis began last June. That troubled Pastor Ghassan Yalda, who urged them to stay.
This is hurting a lot, because the faith that we have is that the Christians are the salt of this land and the light of this land. If everybody leave this country, who are going to be speaking the truth about the people that need us? Who are going to be speaking the truth? And who are going to be keep this area from the wrath of the Lord? Because the sin is everywhere and people are killing each other.
Those still here are reaching out to help.
Here in the Kurdistan capital city of Erbil is a Christian neighborhood known as Ankawa. It usually has a population of about 22,000 people. But because of this massive influx of people from around the country due to the fighting with ISIS, the population here has swelled to over 100,000. That's five times above normal. And what that means is overwhelming pressure on the churches and the community here.
CBN Disaster Relief has partnered with Ankawa Evangelical to relieve some of the pressure, bringing help to Yazidis.
Today we're giving out clothing to the Yazidi people who have fled from northern Iraq. Hey.
And basic food and toiletries for Christians.
We did this because they have very little. They have no money, no ability to purchase anything. They don't have anything other than the clothes on their back.
And it's not just material relief that CBN is providing. Episodes of the animated Bible series Superbook were shown to the refugee children in their own Arabic language.
Through the comfort of the gospel and through the comfort of Superbook, you show that Christians truly love them. They have been able to be blessed and receive relief.
Giving Iraqi refugees a break from their misery, providing them with some of life's basic necessities and spiritual encouragement to last a lifetime. Gary Lane, CBN News, Erbil, Iraq.
Pat, it's great to see CBN minister help and aid to those refugees.
Well, we have to help them. These are fellow Christians, and they've under terrible persecution. But Gary is there in Erbil, and I am so grateful for the Peshmerga and for the courage. That Kurdistan area is something that we really should build up. That would be an enclave of pro-Western support of people who understand that they believe in the democratic process. They may, in some cases, be Muslim, but they are certainly open to the democratic processes, and they've been greatly helped. I mean, those Christians had nowhere to go. So they flee into Kurdistan, that little enclave, and we need to do everything we can to help them. Now, CBN is doing what it can, and again, we have Operation Blessing working in some areas. We have CBN International Relief in the other areas, and again, you can call in and say, I want to give a hand to those people in Iraq that are suffering. Disaster Relief Fund, CBN Center, Virginia Beach. They need our help. And it doesn't take much, but they need something. Well, another hot spot in the world. Is Vladimir Putin going to start a war? Is he playing games? And what is his chess move? He's making them, John.
Pat, another Russian convoy has crossed into Ukraine without permission, this time in an area away from the intense fighting. 10 tanks, 2 armored vehicles, and 2 trucks made their way near the border town of Sherbak overnight, a move that Western leaders see as a possible ploy to arm pro-Russian rebels. Russia says it's delivering aid. The incursion comes as German Chancellor Angela Merkel was in Kiev over the weekend. Her visit showed support for Ukraine's pro-Western government. Both the United States and European Union have demanded Russia withdraw the disputed convoys immediately. Back here in the U.S., tonight's Emmy Awards broadcast will feature a tribute to the late Robin Williams. Like Williams, actor Ben Stein says he, too, struggled with depression and thoughts of suicide. It's unclear if Williams was on antidepressants, but Stein told CBN News the closest he came to actually taking his own life were the times he was taking antidepressants.
The absolute worst I've ever felt in my entire life was under the influence of 2 drugs called Thorazine and Melaril. And they're supposed to make you feel better when you have suicidal thoughts. They had the exact opposite effect, and I really came close to death. And then quite recently, a drug called Wellbutrin, which is a well-known antidepressant, was prescribed to me. And it worked actually well, quite well for about 2 weeks. And then I just felt an overwhelming compulsion to commit suicide. And I stopped taking it and went away. And that being said, if they work for other people, God bless them.
Stein says he has kept depression and thoughts of suicide at bay through prayer, rest, and fresh air, and getting into a 12-step program. Pat, back to you.
Well, I appreciate Ben Stein, that courageous word. He's a nice guy, and I thank him for what he said. The truth is, they're overprescribing these antidepressants. And many, 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 if not 100% of the shooters in these tragic mass killings have been on some kind of antidepressant, some kind of medication. And we don't yet know the full consequences, but they're being prescribed willy-nilly. And as he said, for a couple of weeks he felt good, and all of a sudden he wanted to kill himself. Well, that's what happens to others. Maybe you feel good for a few days, and then you want to kill somebody else. So it's time. I don't know who's going to regulate it, but somebody has got to regulate these things. They're being prescribed by the billions, not millions of tablets, billions. and we're on a nation of some kind of medication, and it's killing us, John.
Pat, governments around the world could have the ability to track almost anyone who has a cell phone, no matter where they are on Earth. The Washington Post reports that the makers of surveillance systems are offering this tracking technology to governments. The systems use the detailed records in cell phone networks that keep track of the phone calls that customers make. The surveillance systems have been secretly collecting these records so they can track people's travel over days, weeks, or even longer. The National Security Agency and similar intelligence organizations have long used cell phone info to track people, but the Post reports experts say the new systems let even less advanced governments now easily track people anywhere. Pat, so much for the idea of privacy.
Well, it's the era of Big Brother. You know, it's said in the book of Revelation, people will come to the time they can't buy or sell without the mark of the beast. That is happening so fast. We're seeing it in our world, that the control we had before us, one of the experts who helped devise the NSA system, he said the goal of the government is total population control. Well, that's the United States government. Now these are little pipsqueak governments, little dictatorships, little lesser, organized societies who now have the ability to track because of the little chips implanted in those cell phones. They know everything about you. There was a frightening piece last night, I don't know if you happened to see it, that indicated that when you log on to certain things on any kind of an app you've got, that all of a sudden there's just this little swarm of people who are listening in and picking up the data.
Wow. So they,
you know?
Yeah, it's unsettling. I mean,
dozens of people know where you buy, where you sell, where you go, what you look at, what your sexual orientation is, what your preference is for food. Unbelievable.
Yeah.
The profile that is being gathered. Forget privacy. Yeah,
pretty much access to it all.
Solar power plants are supposed to be an environmentally friendly source of energy, but a recent report says one of them has slaughtered thousands of birds by accident. It happened at a state-of-the-art solar plant in the Mojave Desert. The plant's mirrors focus the sun's rays onto a water tower to produce steam, which turns turbines to create electricity. But birds have flown through those laser-like rays, getting scorched in midair in a puff of smoke. Federal wildlife investigators report an average of one death every 2 minutes. That could mean up to 20,000 birds killed per year. Critics say it's the latest proof that environmentalists have a double standard when it comes to green energy compared to energy from fossil fuels. CBN's Orphans Promise is providing food and ministry to hundreds of children in Costa Rica. According to official data, one-third of children in Costa Rica are living in poverty. To help these children in need, Orphans Promise established the Soup Kitchen Project in three of the country's most impoverished communities. Through the project, Orphans Promise is providing daily and weekly meals to children. In addition to food, Orphans Promise offers academic support for kids in school and reinforces the importance of Christian values. Well, you can find out more about what CBN is doing around the world by logging on to cbn.com/international.